in gratitude for all who create music in this beautiful space you have here. A few years ago, it was the month of July, I received notice that I was to be on call for jury duty. How many of you have received that notice? Yeah, okay, good. That meant that every evening during the month of July, I'd have to remember to phone in to see if my designated jury number had been selected. If so, I would have to go to court the next morning as one of a large pool of prospective jurors. I'd done this before. My number never came up. That July, however, I arrived home late one night after a long meeting at church. How many of you have had those? Same number. My spouse, Deborah, said that I had received a courtesy call from the jury selection folks. My number had come. After rearranging my scheduled appointments, I showed up at the selected courtroom the next day. There were nearly 40 of us. I don't have time for this, I thought to myself in a rather ugly state of self-importance. Then we were shown a video which effectively reminded me of the importance of this civil duty within a democracy. My self-importance shrank and I began to embrace the process. And the process began, known as voir dire. The origin of this term comes from the Latin verum dicere, which indicates an oath to tell the truth. As a legal procedure, voir dire is defined as a process conducted before trial in which the attorneys and the judge question prospective jurors to determine if any juror is biased or cannot deal with the issues fairly. Some of the reasons a juror might not decide a case fairly include knowledge of the facts, acquaintanceships with the parties, witnesses or attorneys, being acquainted with any of those, or an occupation which might lead to bias. As a group, we were questioned by the judge, which included the question of acquaintanceship. I stood up and said that I was acquainted with one of the attorneys. His wife worked in our office at the time, and I occasionally spoke with him when they had lunch together. As I started to leave, they said, "No, that's not enough." As the process continued, several jurors in front of me were dismissed, and suddenly there I was in the jury box. I looked at the four attorneys. They were all considerably younger than me. I've reached that age where I could be their mother and now perhaps their grandmother. The attorneys had notes from profile questions, which we had all filled out in May. The fact that I had practiced law for a short time and now was a minister seemed to be of great intrigue. Reverend Macklin, a prosecuting attorney, addressed me. "I see you chose ministry over practicing law." "Well, yes, I did," I responded, or really what I thought was, "Ministry chose me." "It appears," he said, "you have chosen the nobler profession." Then I thought about all the clergy scandals that erupt and all the headlines in the newspaper, and I just said, "That's debatable." Then he looked at me curiously, but soon that was replaced by a very serious demeanor. He stepped towards me, in fact, and said, "As a minister, as a religious leader, I know that forgiveness is an important part of your profession." He paused. I knew where this was going, the part of voir dire where my occupation might lead to bias. "Do you believe," he asked, "we always should forgive?" At that moment, a decade of sermons on forgiveness converged in my head. Should, I thought, should forgive? On the face, like a simple question. Then I heard Amy Owens going around in my head. The term forgiveness has been so misused in our culture. You cannot rush the process of forgiveness. It takes time. It's not a panacea. It's not for everyone. There are times in which the only thing a person has left is their anger, and they need to hold on to that for their own sanity. Should forgive? Then I thought about the complexities of forgiveness, the endless research that has offered some answers but left so many unknowns. I thought about the story of Reverend Macklin. I heard a youthful voice bring me back to the courtroom. Reverend Macklin. Oh, yeah, Well, I hesitated. The process of forgiveness is not part of my role in this courtroom as a juror. It's my understanding that I'm here to listen to the evidence and determine by the rules of law presented if the defendant is guilty or not guilty regarding the issue being prosecuted. And that's what I will do. Oh, he said, and took a step back. That's interesting. He jotted a few notes. I spoke the truth, but a part of me wanted to summon Amy Owens as an expert witness right then and there. But I was not the attorney. I was selected to be on the jury that morning. And that morning, we all did our duty. Author Madeline Lingle, who some of you may know from the book A Wrinkle in Time, likens forgiveness to the setting of a table and not knowing what guest will arrive. And in all my years, it's my favorite metaphor. It's a setting of the table. She says that ultimately forgiveness is a gift of grace rather than an act of will. What she says is, I can choose to be willing to forgive, but I cannot will myself to forgive. Those are two very different things. I can forgive with my mind, that intellectual part that sometimes does that so quickly, sometimes too quickly. But forgiveness is finally a matter of the heart. The author and spiritual teacher, Jack Kornfield, states, forgiveness is one of the greatest gifts of the spiritual life. For most people, forgiveness is a process. When you have been deeply wounded, the work of forgiveness can take years. It can go through stages of grief and rage, sorrow, fear, and confusion, and in the end, if you can let yourself feel the pain you carry, it will come as a relief, as a release then for your heart. The fate of the person you harmed, whether alive or dead, does not matter nearly as much as what you carry in your heart. Kornfield says, and if the forgiveness is for yourself, for your own guilt, for the harm you've done to yourself or to another, the process is the same. You will come to realize that you simply no longer want to carry that. So forgiveness can help us lessen that heavy load so many of us are carrying. Are there so many of us carrying heavy loads in our world today? I would say, oh, yes. From our own personal pains and loss and grief, as indicated in some of the stones today, concerns, frustrations with our country's current administration, the instability of our president, let alone the violence that continues in homes, in states, in countries. The residue of these frustrating emotions then seep into our lives. The Princeton psychologist Robert Lefnoe found that in the United States, 37% of us have recently had serious conflict with a spouse, a partner, or someone near us. 36% are moving through something painful from our upbringing. 32% face serious conflict at work. And most of us, 60%, are trying to forgive someone else, and nearly half of us are trying to forgive ourselves. In other words, according to Lefnoe, we Americans are carrying a lot. Now, sharing with others can help lighten that load. Again, Lefnoe says that learning to forgive does not mean we suddenly have all the answers. I've been preaching on this forever, and I certainly do not. But we do not have to undertake the journey alone. Being with others helps us to move beyond that intellectual understanding of forgiveness, by working through some of our feelings and getting in touch then with an even deeper part of our inner being. Still, with all this research and numbers, forgiveness remains such a mystery. For instance, why is something sometimes a monumental piece? I've had this in my life, and I've found the forgiveness journey not easy, but smooth. And then something else which seems small, I get completely stuck. At a recent board meeting, we were talking about church employees and time cards, and I suddenly felt myself bristle. I was feeling uncomfortable. You know, the rain. raising of the hackles from a long time ago. And I had this bit of a flashback from when I served a different congregation. Now, there was an employee. One of our employees was always complimenting the ministers, showering us with praises, and saying how great it was to work for us. In the end, I guess it was great to work for us because this employee had been fudging time cards and making money off of our institution. In the end, actually, we were able to create minimal loss. But sitting there at that board meeting recently, I could still feel the residual resentment from that experience so long ago, for being sucked in and blinded by this person's sugar-coated admirations. I'd enjoyed that, and I had been duped, and I don't like being duped. I realized that part of this forgiveness journey was making the turn to forgive myself. I thought I was just still resentful of the other person. And I just read something recently that research is showing that if humiliation is involved in the experience we're working through, it's one of the biggest roadblocks. It makes forgiveness even more complicated because it becomes a forgiveness outward as well as inward. I had to forgive myself for being duped. In a recent book, Life is a Trip, former Hollywood screenwriter and current travel journalist Judith Fine explores forgiveness in a chapter entitled Searching for Forgiveness in Vietnam. I hadn't looked at that book for about a year, but with the recent PBS series that came out about Vietnam, I got it out again. I've traveled with Judy Fine. She has an amazing knack of bypassing the tourist aspects of travel and embracing the soul and the destination of the people. She embodies the transformative magic of travel. So, 2 years prior to the book, she had traveled to Vietnam. She enlisted the help of a guy named Quang, a former Viet Cong guerrilla fighter. Fine herself had left the United States during the Vietnam War for 9 years because she was so angry and disturbed by the loss of young American lives, the million of Vietnamese that had been killed and maimed with our arsenals of weapons, defoliants, deceits, and disinformation. So she went there and she started asking, how have you managed to put the American War behind you? Because she kept finding that was true for people. And the answers were very similar. The Vietnamese are so happy not to be at war or under foreign occupation that they are concentrating on the present, on making money and bettering themselves. For most, their focus is on now and the future, what some people call present forward. The war represents the past. Like I said, Judy tends to go deep, so she said, do you mean you really have no resentment against us? And for the most part, the answers again were similar. No, they would say, and then they would add, you are forgiven. It was an enormous relief, Judy said, to know that Vietnam has survived our war and is thriving. It was reassuring to learn that life has moved on, and even when a country is bombed, defoliated, destroyed, it can come back with great vigor. She said she was humbled by the people who had suffered so much and had chosen forgiveness over fury. She met with a group of ex-Viet Cong guerrilla fighters, and they told her, we have met with American soldiers who come back here. They come a lot. They arrive here so full of guilt, and some want to apologize. They go to the villages where they've killed people, and we embrace them, and we even cry together. Now, some of us still have had memories, and we do still have nightmares, but we don't suffer nearly as much as what we see in those American GIs. I turned away, Fine says, and a few tears coursed down my cheeks. There are several hundred thousand Vietnam veterans living on the streets of America, purportedly more committed suicide after the war than had died in combat. PTSD wrecks relationships and ruins lives. And then finds mine, like my own, drifts to Iraq, Iran, Afghanistan. One day when the insanity stops, when Iraq or Afghanistan finally know peace and have been built, will they too be able to forgive? And how do we go about forgiving ourselves in these times? And she recalls one night in a park in Hanoi. She met a silver-haired man dressed just in beige pants, sandals, and a white short-sleeved shirt. His grace suggested, she said, someone who had practiced Tai Chi for decades. In fact, he had been a Viet Cong soldier and then did menial labor most of his life, and yet, she said, he spoke with the wisdom of a philosopher. He did say, I was eaten up with anger when I was younger. So I spent many years in meditation and thinking about anger and whom I was angry at. Were the soldiers who came here to fight any different from me? I didn't want to go to war. But once I was forced to, I did whatever I had to do in order to survive. There was no difference, he finally found, between the American soldiers and himself. He said, we were both caught up in a situation and a circumstance. When I realized that, I was able to give up my anger. Now I think of the soldiers with compassion. And Judy says her guide, Huang, chimed in and said, I didn't want to go to war either. What did I know or care about Lenin and socialism at age 18? I wanted to stay home and play rock and roll songs on my guitar. I loved the Beatles. I sang Let It Be all the time. But then the war. And I lived in the jungle on the verge of starvation for 5 years with no news of my family. In my squad of 12, only two of us survived. I have scars from a grenade on my scalp. My leg was wounded. But I don't see it as the fault of the soldiers. Life is good now. Forget the past. I live in the present. After what I went through, I never take anything for granted. I appreciate everything. I appreciate everything. Every little thing at each moment. Because I forgave those soldiers a long, long time ago. Reverend Macklin, a young attorney's voice, queries from earlier in the summer. Do you believe we should forgive? I turn to this voice again. Should forgive? Should forgive? It's such a mystery, forgiveness. Much forgiveness often involves self-forgiveness, even when it doesn't make sense. And this is something I just recently learned. About 10 years ago, I took up a sport I never thought I'd like, golf. Part of it because so much of golf takes place right between here. It's a lot about how your mind is working. And I bought a book about how to better your golf game, and it had to do with spirituality a little bit. And it had this exercise that said, if you want to improve your golf game, list all your resentments. So I did. Then it said, after each one, say, I forgive myself. Now, some of those didn't make sense because there's no way I could have been responsible for what happened. Yet, I found I did need to forgive myself. It made no sense. It was irrational. And yet, I'm an overly responsible person, and I'd taken on some things I didn't need to take on. So I went through my resentments and said, I forgive myself for that. Some of it didn't make sense. I forgive myself. I did some meditation around some of it. My golf game got better, as did my ministry, of course. In the book, The Art of Forgiveness, Loving Kindness and Peace, the Buddhist teacher, Jack Kornfield, who I mentioned earlier, offers words may sound very similar to what Amy Owens had to say. Forgiveness is a letting go of past suffering and betrayal, a release of the burden of pain and hate that we carry. But forgiveness honors the heart's greater dignity. Whenever we are lost, it brings us back to the ground of love. With forgiveness, we become unwilling to attach or wish harm to another, or sometimes feeling irrationally responsible ourselves and not even realizing it. Whenever we forgive, in small ways at home or in great ways, maybe in traumatic events, forgiveness is a way we free ourselves from the past. And then he offers this short dialogue between two former prisoners of war. "Have you forgiven your captors yet?" one asks, and the other says, "No, never." And the other responds, "Well then, they still have you in prison, don't they?" Much of the work of forgiveness really begins primarily for ourselves. And let us remember, forgiveness is not weak or naive, and it does not always happen quickly. And it's not 100% like, I've either forgiven or I've not. Sometimes we're 75% in there, sometimes we have been forgiven and then something happens later and it kicks up stuff for us again. It's not a 100% proposition, it's a process. And let us remember those five things observed by those who work with the dying, five things a dying person often yearns to hear. Thank you, I love you, please forgive me, I forgive you, goodbye, I'll miss you. I think I preached this sermon because I want to say don't wait. You don't have to wait till you're dying to express this to the people you care about. I want to close with words from someone who is, I think, or was, a modern-day saint. She died several years ago. Maya Angelou. She says, "I don't know if I continue even today always liking myself. But what I learned to do many years ago was to forgive myself. It is very important for every human being to forgive herself or himself, themselves, because if you live, you will make mistakes. It's inevitable. It's part of life. But once you do and you see the mistake, then forgive yourself and say, well, if I'd known better, I'd have done better. That's it. So you say to people who think you may have injured, I'm sorry. And then you say to yourself, I'm sorry. If I'd known better, I wouldn't have gotten duped. And I didn't know better, and I got duped. Sorry. If we all hold on to the mistake, we can't see our own glory in the mirror because we have that mistake between our face and the mirror, Angelou tells us. We can't see what we're capable of being. You can ask forgiveness of others, but in the end, the real forgiveness is in one's own self. I think that young men and women today are so caught by the way they see themselves. Now, mind you, she says, when the larger society sees them as unattractive or sometimes as threats, they're too black or too white or too poor or not too black or too white or something else or too fat or too thin or too sexual or too asexual. It's rough when all of this is coming at you. But we can all overcome that. The real difficulty is to overcome how you think about yourself. To love yourself, to forgive yourself, so then that love comes out to others. And if we don't have that, we never grow, says Angelou. And we never learn. So this sermon continues. A work in progress. A work in progress. So love may guide us. Our closing hymn is number 131. Please rise and body your spirit to sing along.